Hi, this is MCZetti for a new tutorial in my 1.14 modding series. So, in this episode we are going to talk about a bit more fancy render mechanisms that are available, more in particular baked models. So, I prepared everything already. So we made a new block, it's called Fancy Block. It's just the basic stuff. It also defines a shape, .2.2.2.8.8.8.8, and we return that here. So that means that our block isn't a regular shaped block starting at 0 till 1, but it's smaller and it floats a bit. So that's how you can create shapes. And by the way, you can also make combinations and simplify and so on. There are lots of things you can do with voxel shapes. It's really interesting. And here we override the cat shape in general, but you can actually, there are methods, get render shape, for example, get render shape, there is get collision shape. So you can override various other shapes to get different shapes based on what the purpose is. That can be useful in some cases, but in this case we just want the same shape for everything, so that's why we do this. We add our object holder here, and we add the registration here, and the registration of the block item. Just standard stuff, nothing special. Okay. So what do we do as well? We have also added an entry in the loot tables, no recipe yet. We're not going to generate them right now, that's not important. It's just something you can easily do now with this system. Then we make our model. By the way, we also have a JSON, very simple, doesn't do anything special. And we have a texture. But you'll notice that we don't have a model. There's no model here, not an item model, because that one we will define with baked models, and I will explain how that works now. So basically we have a baked model. It's a bit more complicated, so let me explain how it, what it has. It's a dynamic baked model. That's an interface you have to implement. We have one parameter for the constructor, which is the format, because we want to use this model for in-world, so that's the block format, as well as the item format when it is in the user interface. So that's why we give this as a parameter, because it influences how you should bake your model. Baking model means converting a model to something that can be rendered directly by the Minecraft render system. So that format is only used here in this private method, putVertex. So basically what we want to do here, we have our builder, which is to make quads, and a quad is a rectangle, which will be part of our model. So because we want to have a cubic model, we are going to add 6 quads, but we'll see that later. It has a normal, which is important for lighting. It's basically a vector that points orthogonal to the surface of the quad. And that way lighting looks okay. This is the coordinate of the vertex. These are the texture map coordinates of the vertex. This is the sprite. And a sprite, what is a sprite? Basically, when you have normal textures like this one, it's the fancy block texture that we made here. Minecraft, when it loads and when it finds all textures, it will bake them into an atlas texture. An atlas texture is basically a very big texture, usually more than 1,000 on 1,000 texture resolution, and it contains all the block textures. The reason it does that is that's much more optimal for the 3D hardware to treat most as a single texture. It makes it more efficient, and the Texture Atlas Sprite is a class in Minecraft that that indicates where on the atlas our current texture is. And then we have three colors. And based on the format, so we iterate over the elements in the format, we put the right floating points onto the builder to make our quad. So we don't know in what format, so what order all these floating points need to be, because that's the format that decides that. That's why this format is a parameter here, so our model can be used for multiple situations. Here is where we make a quad. We have four vectors, just the four corners of the quad and the sprite. We calculate a normal, that's mathematics. So we have we use only three vectors to calculate the normal. That's provided this one is on the same plane, that works. And we are going to assume that these are on the same plane. So we calculate the normal by subtracting v3 minus v2 and times cross product v in v1 minus v2, and then we normalize that so that it's a vector of length 1. And here we make our builder for the quad, we set the sprite, we put our vertices, and we use color 1, which is full bright, and these are the coordinates on the texture itself, because our texture is 16 by 16, we use this. And then we return the baked quad here. This is a small convenience function. For this function later, it just defines a very short function phi, which just creates a new vec3d. It makes this a bit more a bit shorter. This is the important function of our baked model. It actually returns the quads, so the rectangles that make up our model based on the state, the site that we want to render, random from the world. This can be used, for example, to have the appearance slightly different, for example, slightly offset textures for if you want, and extra data, which we will cover later. The quads are obtained side by side, so there it for every block this will actually be called, as far as I know, 7 times, once for every site and once in general. And that's the one we are interested in. We only want to render because this is important for visibility culling, but in our case our model is smaller than the block space, so we don't need visibility culling. So we're only going to render if site is equal to null. So we get our texture, which is this routine. So based on our resource location, we get the texture map, which is the big atlas that I talked about, and we find our texture there. And we make a list of quads, and then we define 6 quads. So those are the 6 sides of our block, or of our mini block. These are just, we put the numbers here to make it easier to write. That's just the convenience. These are a few methods that you have to implement like this. This is the particle texture, which is used when the block is being broken, and it's just the same texture in our case. This is not used here, that's for properties that you can use in the JSON. This is the transforms, and because we want for the GUI, we want our model to be rotated, so that's why we use a special transform for the GUI, like this. Because otherwise you could also have returned this one, which is a default transformation, but that works fine for inside the world, but it makes the item model look straight on, which is not very nice for a cube. So that's basically the baked model. So how do we actually use this? And for that we need let's clean up some imports. So this is the client registration where we put our client-specific events. So this one we had for item coloring, that's for previous episode. And then we need two things. First, we want Minecraft at the time that textures are baked onto the big atlas. It doesn't know about our texture yet. So we need to tell it that it also has to bake our fancy block texture on that big atlas, and that you do in the texture stitch event. You only do it for this in this case. If it's not equal to textures, you just return, because there are multiple atlases used for other things, and you only want on the base textures atlas. And here we just say add sprite, new resource location, block, fancy block, and that makes sure that Minecraft knows our texture, and because it's in the pre, so the texture stitching hasn't been done yet, it will make place for fancyblock.png and put it in the atlas somewhere. And that's how we can do this here. It puts it in there. Also for the model, we have to do something similar. Model bake event. So we put for model, which is a model resource location, for the registry name of our block. And this is for the standard world model. We use fancy bake model with the format block. So that's going to be used for in-world rendering. And then we also do exactly the same, but for inventory. And we put the item format here. So that's how the different formats work. And we use the same model, but with a different format in different situations. I think that's actually it. That's all there is to it. So let's just try it out. Okay, so here you see it. You see it's a smaller model, and yeah, it looks like we have defined it. Also, if you check in the inventory, you see this is also the model, and it's rotated because that's the rotation we defined here. You can also scale it and translate it for different kinds of effects. You also see it's rather big in our hand, so to fix that, you could change these to return other transforms. So you have some control there on how the model looks under various circumstances. So that works, but this isn't everything. If this was it, you could just have well and much easier, much better use just a JSON model, because to make a block like this, you don't need baked models at all. That's not needed. It's too much work for a simple thing that you can just specify in JSON directly with a correct model. But we are going to use to extend this. We are going to make something more interesting. So now we come on the second part of this tutorial, and we are making things a bit more interesting. I'm going to first show you what exactly goes on, and then I will explain how I did this. Okay, so let's try it out. We place a few of our blocks there, and then right click. You see, we made our block mimic whatever you right click it with. For torches, that doesn't seem to work very well. Let's see what else we can try. Flower. Rose bush. Yeah, so these, because they have a texture that has transparency, so that's why these are not working well. But the pure models work perfect, so that's good. Want a few diamond blocks? There you have them. And you can always change it by right-clicking. So let's explain how this works. So the first thing we did was add a tile entity, because, well, let's start here. We have, when our block is activated by right-clicking it, we check if we have something in our hand, and we check if the item extends is an instance of block item, because that means it's placeable. If that's the case, we will in any case return true because we handled the activation. Otherwise, we will just use the default activation. In case we have an item, a block item, we only do this on the server side. We go get the tile entity of our current position, which is our fancy block tile entity. If it's the correct instance, always check this for safety reasons. Then we get the default state from the block from the item that we are holding. That's what we want to mimic. And we set that on our tile entity. So that way, whenever we right click, we will set the change what we are mimicking. We also added these two for tile entity, and then we made our tile entity like this. I will explain that in a moment. We just added these lines and we added this line, just the standard stuff for tile entity, nothing special. I was going to say nothing fancy, but it's fancy, it's a fancy tile. So our tile entity is just a basic tile entity, it has no capabilities or anything. It has one field, which is what we are mimicking. And here is our set mimic. So we change that field, we mark dirty so that our read and write NBT will be called when the chunk is saved. And we do a notify block update to make sure that our server side change will be sent to the client, like this. Okay, so we also implement read and write to store our what we are mimicking, so it's remembered when we restart the world. And there's in NBT util, there's a convenience method to read and write block states. So these are always handy. Then, when this is called, we notify block update. That means we send our change to the client. And then what happens is we create, this is called, we override get update packet, which is a packet that will be sent to the client containing all the information it needs to re-render. In our case, we make a new compound NBT and we put our mimic state in it and we put that in the update tile packet. So this will be sent to the client, this packet. So you, here you can control what you want to put in that packet, your own information. And on the client side, this will be called. That's when the packet is received. We remember the state of what we are mimicking, the old. So we are client side now. We check the packet, the NBT, which will contain our mimic. We read the block state. And if it's different, then we do request model data refresh. I will explain that to you in a moment. And we also do the notify block update, which on the client side will force a re-render of the block. This is important. Did something new in 1.14. We use model data, which is provided here. And it's a way to communicate data from the tile entity to the baked model. And we just have one property in it, which is called, it's a model property, and it's a property of type block state, and it's called mimic. So that's the block we want to mimic. And whenever this is done on the model side, on the client side, then this get model data will be called again, and we can use that from our baked model. So in the baked model, what has changed here? So there was already this extra parameter, but we added this thing before this test to make sure it will render on all sides, because we don't know the model of what we are mimicking. It perhaps only renders on specific sides, so that's why we have to do this. So we get our property, extra data get data mimic, and by the way, always make sure that what you do in get data, this can be run on another thread, on the rendering thread. So be careful, don't do too much in here. Just accessing variables like this, which are set in the main thread, is probably the best way to handle this. So from our block state, we get the model location. From that location, from the model manager, we get the baked model. And from the baked model, we can call getQuads. So if we have a mimic, if we are mimicking something, we will call the getQuads from that model instead of doing this. So that's an easy way that you can use to mimic existing blocks in the world. It's something that can be useful. You can, for example, use this if you have a cable mod and you want to be able to hide your cables, then you can do something like this, for example. So that concludes this tutorial. If you have any questions, feel free to ask, and see you next time. By the way, I think next time will probably be something where I will explain networking, because I haven't touched that yet, and also comments with Brigadier, which is new in 1.14. So see you next time. Bye bye.